So here we are back at Lake Rotomahana, and we've come here after almost a year. So what we're doing now is we're going back on the lake and we're going to map the lake floor or the bathymetry in a resolution of less than a metre. So we're using this vessel here from IX Survey. They have a very sophisticated piece of kit here that send down acoustic waves. They bounce off the lake floor and they come back. And depending on how fast they go and how long it takes, we can figure out what the bottom of the lake floor looks like. So we're particularly excited to have a look at these results and see if we can stitch together a story about the 1886 eruption. So here we are in the operations room back in Rotorua, and this is where Chris and some of our other colleagues have been processing some of the information that's been coming through from the boats. So last year with the AUV we produced this bathymetric map of the lake. This year with IX Survey we remapped the lake, and you can see this incredible difference between the two maps. So in this very detailed map we can see a number of clear features that haven't been seen by anybody since the 1886 eruption. So this is a bathymetric map and the colours represent different depths. So if we start looking at this area here, this area is very significant for us because this is the promontory that we saw in our previous map of last year, and it places us, when we look at some of the old photographs, very near the pink terraces. So if we move further around the lake, this is the area of where the white terraces used to be. You can see this ridge coming down here that was commonly known as the pinnacle and appears in Bloomfield's paintings immediately after the eruption. We also see, which has not been seen by anybody for over 100 years, the craters that currently exist on the bottom of the lake floor. And you can see a beautiful one here. We see as we come near the island, there's a couple of prominent ridges here. These ridges are almost certainly the margins of some sort of explosion craters. And then on the south side of the lake, we see these incredible textures of slumping coming down from sort of the lower lying areas down into the lake. So just to the north of the slump is this an incredible area of pockmarks. We discovered this last year with our UVs, a lot of gas coming out here, and this is the new geothermal system that's only been around since the eruption of 1886. So this map is going to prove to be a treasure for us for a number of years to come, because the detail is such that we can try and resurrect what truly happened on that fateful day of June 10th, 1886 during the Mount Tarawera eruption. And all of these details, which has previously been unseen by anybody's eyes, will help us try and reconstruct those events. So over the course of the last 125 years since the eruption, the lake has filled up with sediment to some degree, coming in from the margins of the lake and outwash, if you like, from the very steep slopes of where that mud was deposited. So what we try to do after the bathymetry here is to really see if we can look through the lake sediments to see if we can see that eruption surface of 1886. And this is done through what we call with boomer seismics. And what we're able to do, if you like, is to send sound waves through the bottom of the lake to see if we can see through the sediment and see that eruption surface of 1886. This is a cross-section that's gone virtually the length of the lake. You can see the sediments, very nicely layered sediments, on the bottom of the lake. And then underneath that you can see these reflectors, and this almost certainly represents the 1886 surface or thereabouts, which was since been covered by the sediments as the lake rose. So in the previous one we had a look at line 100, which ran all the way along the length of the lake, and now I'm going to show you a cross section through the lake here, and then we'll come back through another one over here. And you can see these beautiful sloping sides, and that is the rift axis, if you like, of the Tarawera rift as it came down through the lake. And then again you can see these beautiful sediments that are on the bottom of the lake floor, and underneath you can see this more undulating surface with the hard reflectors, and that's almost certainly the 1886 eruption surface or thereabouts. Looking at the other section towards the west a bit more, here's all the sediments once again, and it's this area over here of great interest to us, because this is the area that we thought, if the pink terraces or any remnants beyond what we saw last year were to exist, this is the most likely place that they would be. So this is a close-up of the boomer seismics over that area, and you can see it's a pile of what we would call fairly hard reflectors, as given by the brightness of the colours, and with a particularly hard reflector in here. where we've seen this pile of hard reflectors is right up this small sort of little valley here, which puts us with the arcuate shape of land out towards the east. And here's that arcuate piece of land. And this little definitive line down here, we think of the buttresses along here, which we saw in the side scan sonar back last year. So what we've ended up with is a scenario where we have a pile of 20 meter thick odd hard reflectors where they should be if they're going to be the pink terraces. What we've not been able to resolve is the absolute definitions of any individual terraces, because the resolution of the seismics won't allow that. But you know, I believe that we've probably found the remnants of those pink terraces, but what their actual preservation state is, we can't discern.